يا إمام الرسل يا سندي أنت باب الله معتمدي فبدنياي وآخرتي
يا رسول الله
خذ بيدي.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. After praising Allah سبحانه وتعالى and sending salutations, peace and blessings upon the best of creation, the jewel and crown of creation, the beloved of Allah Almighty, the coolness to our eyes, the purpose of our lives, the reviver of our hearts, the inspirer to our minds, the awakener of our souls, the most honored one, the most praised one, the most generous one, the most kind one, the most beautiful one, none other than Sayyiduna wa Nabiyuna Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi wa barak wa sallam. From amongst the most famous companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the companions being those who are the first generation of Muslims, the first recipients of Islam, the first students of the Quran, those who met the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and believed in him and then passed away upon this belief, such individuals are referred to as ashab, companions, and they are the best companions, about whom the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Khayrul Quruni Karni, the best generation is my generation. Thumma alladhina yalunahum. Then it's the generation after mine, then it's the generation after mine. About whom the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Jalla wa ala said, Kuntum khayra ummatin ukhrijat linnas. تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون عن المنكر وتؤمنون بالله. That you are the best generation, you are the best ummah, and who were the ones and the starters of this ummah from the beginning, it was the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Kathir writes that there were around 100 and other muhaddithin, 124,000 give or take companions. And from these 124,000 companions, male and female, there were 313 who were very special. For these 313 whom were very special were the first recipients or the first participants in the way of Allah to fight. They were the first mujahideen. They were the first soldiers of Islam. And the first major battle they fought in was the battle of Badr. In the battle of Badr, in the plains of Badr, there were 313 companions who fought in this battle. And with the exception of one from the Al-Asharatul Mubashara, the 10 who were promised paradise. The 10 whom were promised paradise are those about whom the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in this world, before they passed away, said, Abu Bakr fil Jannah, Umar fil Jannah, Uthman fil Jannah, Ali fil Jannah, Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah fil Jannah, Abdul Rahman ibn Auf fil Jannah, Sa'ad bin Abi Waqas fil Jannah, Talha bin Ubaidillah fil Jannah, Zubair ibn al-Awwam fil Jannah, and Sa'id ibn Zayd fil Jannah. These are 10 whom were promised paradise whilst the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was still alive. Abu Bakr is in paradise, and Umar is in paradise, and Uthman is in paradise, and Ali is in paradise, and Abu Ubaidah is in paradise. Talha is in paradise, and Zubair is in paradise, and Sa'ad is in paradise, and Abdul Rahman ibn Auf is in paradise, and Sa'id ibn Zayd is in paradise. Yani these are the 10 closest companions, the closest friends of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we all know about the four rightly guided caliphs, the Al-Khulafa al-Rashidun, Sayyidina Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman and Ali radiyallahu anhum. We know about them. Every time it's the day of birth or the day of departure from this world, scholars, imams, khutaba, speakers and lecturers, they will deliver sermons and talks on their lives, the life of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, the achievements of Sayyidina Abu Bakr, the life of Sayyidina Umar, the greatness of Sayyidina Umar, the life of Sayyidina Uthman, the life and the virtues of Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhum. But the other six major companions, famous companions, like Sayyidina Talha and Sayyidina Zubair, Sayyidina Abdul Rahman ibn Auf and Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah and Sa'id ibn Zayd and Sayyidina Sa'ad ibn Abi Waqqas, we don't hear much about them. Yet they are equally as important. They were the founding pillars of this deen. They were the first members of the Muslim community. One of the qualities of these 10 companions is that they were the earliest of the earliest Muslims. They accepted Islam in the first year, 2-3 years. Within the first 3 years, these 10 famous companions accepted Islam. They hadn't accepted Islam after Badr or Uhud or Khandaq or after the conquest of Mecca. There were companions who accepted Islam after the conquest of Mecca. There were 13 years in Mecca, and then there was around 7 or 8 years in Medina Munawwara. In the 8th year of Hijri was the conquest of Mecca. 13 plus 8 is 21. Yani there were some people who accepted Islam 21 years after the announcement of prophethood. 21 years. But these were those who accepted right at the beginning. No doubt the one who accepted after 21 years and the one who accepted at the beginning, they are both companions. They will both be respected and honored and venerated. But surely the one who accepted at the beginning, in terms of rank and status, is far greater than the one who accepted after the conquest of Mecca. Of course, those who were participated during Shi'bi Abi Talib, there was a 3-year social boycott on the Muslims, heavily documented and recorded in history, that for 3 years the Muslims were persecuted to the extent in Mecca that they were forced to leave their homes and take refuge in the valley of Abu Talib. They took refuge in the valley of Abu Talib and they had to stay there for 3 years. And the situation got so bad, so difficult in Makkah Mukarramah for the Muslims in those 3 years, the social boycott that the chiefs of Makkah embargoed upon the Muslims, that for 3 years there are narrations that some of them had to live on the leaves of trees. They would take dry leaves, they would put and soak them into water, and then they would eat and drink that water. Such was the state of hardship that the earliest Muslims experienced. Surely their rank in the sight of Allah is greater than those who came after them. And there is no dispute and there is no question in regards to that. And if we look at those who through thick and thin participated and experienced and witnessed this, a name which props up time and time again, aside from the Al-Khulafa al-Rashidun, is the name of a man called Amir ibn Abdullah ibn al-Jarrah. He's very famously known as Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And today I want you to go away from this Jummah sermon and lecture knowing who this companion was. His name is Amir. He's the son of Abdullah, who is the son of al-Jarrah. But he's famously, his agnomen, his laqab or kunniya, what he was famously known as, what everyone, most people, most Muslims will know him as, is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. Abu Ubaidah. And this man, Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah, he was born in Makkah Mukarramah, going back six generations, six grandfathers. His lineage meets with the lineage of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, going back six generations. And if we look at Sayyidina Ali, for example, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu, his relation to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is going back how many generations? One generation. Hatta the same generation. Sayyidina Ali's father and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father were brothers. So their grandfather was the same. They were, that's the closest cousin of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Amongst the companions is a very famous companion known as Abbas. Sayyidina Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib. Sayyidina Abbas is so close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How? He is Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam's uncle. He is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's uncle. Sayyidina Hamza, very famous, Asadullah wa Asadur Rasul. He was known as the Lion of Allah. His nickname was the Lion of Allah. The one who fought valiantly in Uhud. He's so close to Rasulullah that he is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's uncle. Hazrat Abbas, Sayyidina Abbas, Sayyidina Hamza are brothers. And they are stepbrothers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's father, Sayyidina Abdullah. So we must know the life of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, their uncles, their cousins. Sayyidina Ali is a cousin. Abdullah ibn Abbas is a cousin. Another famous companion from the ten is Zubair. Sayyidina Zubair. These are names that we all know. If you got a friend called Zubair, you should know why he's called Zubair. Why was he named after Zubair? Maybe because his grandfather's name was Zubair, or the father's best friend's name was Zubair, or uncle's name was Zubair. But remember, Zubair's name came from Sayyidina Zubair, radiallahu anhu. Zubair, radiallahu anhu, he is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's cousin brother. He is the auntie son, pupo son, who? Sayyidah Safiya radiallahu anha son. Sayyidina Zubair is Sayyidah Safiya's son. Sayyidah Safiya is Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's auntie, paternal auntie. She and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam's father were brother sister. So this was the paternal auntie, and Sayyidina Zubair was related. So if we look through lineage, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah's lineage to the Prophet alayhi salam goes back six generations. So he was a distant relative of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam through a grandfather named Fihr. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah radiyallahu an, his mother's name was Umayma bint Ghanam, and his father's name was Abdullah ibn al-Jarrah. His agnoman, he was known as Abu Ubaidah, and he was mostly known by this. And if you look at his physical description, how he looked, the ulama have written, كان رجلا نحيفا معروك الوجه خفيف اللحية طوال أحنا أثرم الثنيتين. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah, his physical description, his appearance, physical appearance, was such that he was a slim, tall man. Very slim. Not too much meat on his body. Slim and tall. And he radiallahu anhu had a very thin face, and he had a small beard. Small meaning here, a sparsely beard, little bit of hair on his face. And he radiallahu anhu was hunchback. So he was tall and he was slightly hunchbacked. And he had no front teeth. And we will come to the story of how he lost his front teeth. It is said that he had two sons by the name of Yazid and Umair, who were given birth to by his wife Hind bin Jabir ibn Wahab ibn Dabab al ibn Hujair, and they had both passed away in their infancy. Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah's lineage, or Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah's progeny, hadn't continued because both his sons passed away at a young age. He didn't have a progeny. So, for example, my grandfather had my father then myself, and tomorrow I have children. If I don't have children tomorrow, this progeny from my side has ceased. So progenies continue. And if we look in terms of nasab, progeny, just a point, a side note here, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, my progeny continues from Fatima. Yet if we look through history, the progeny of a man continues from the father, not the daughter. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, "Kullu nasabin wa hasabin munqati'un illa nasabi wa hasabi." Every lineage will end, will cease up until the day of judgment, except my bloodline. My bloodline will continue till the day of Qiyamah. Meaning that the bloodline continues from two companions, two of the grandchildren. Because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam's father, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam had two sons, three sons. All three of them passed away in the infancy. So how did the progeny of Rasulullah alayhi salam, the bloodline continue? Through Sayyidah Fatima. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said, I am the one from whom the lineage continues. And it continued from two streams, Sayyiduna Hassan and Sayyiduna Hussein. And those who are Sadat, those who are Ashraf, a Sharif or a Sayyid, those who are descendants of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, those descendants of Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam are known as Sadat or Sayyid. Or they are known as Shahs, or they are known as Ashraf, Sharif. In the Arab world, they are known as Ashraf. These are Naqibul Ashraf. These are the noble family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These are Ghilani, or these are from the descendants of Imam al-Idrisi and so on and so forth. These Sadat, the bloodline from Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein. So sometimes you find a Sayyid who is Hassani Sayyid. Sometimes you find a Sayyid, a descendant of the Prophet ﷺ, who is Husayni Sayyid. He's from the Imam Hussein's lineage. And sometimes you find a Sayyid who is Hassani and Husayni. Father may be Hassani, mother may be Husayni. Like Sayyidina Abdul Qadir al-Ghilani. He was Hassani and Husayni, Najib al-Ashraf. Najib al-Tarafain. He was Sayyid from both sides. So you find that the Sadat, the lineage, the progeny continues. And Nabi alayhi salatu wasalam said that my progeny will not enter the fire of Jahannam. He who carries my blood will not, the fire of hell will not touch that individual who carries the blood of Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And those who are the progeny descendants of Sayyidina Ali, from Sayyidina Ali's side, just Sayyidina Ali are known as Alawites, Alawi. They are Alawis, they are not Sayyids. They are Alawis, meaning they are the offspring of Sayyidina Ali. Because Sayyidina Ali, after Sayyida Fatima had passed away, married again. So he had a son called Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah. And whoever's from Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyyah would be known and referred to as an Alawi. So Sadat is different, Alawi is different. Then you have Abbasi. Those who are descendants of Sayyidina Abbas, they are known as Abbasis. They are known as the Abbasis. So I know people who are descendants of Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu anhu. Their lineage, their trees go back. So their father to the grandfather, to the great-grandfather, to the great-grandfather, to the great-great, all the way back to Sayyidina Abbas radiallahu anhu. And they have a shajara, a tree, family tree. So how many generations can me and you go back? Three. I know my father's name, my grandfather's name, my great-grandfather's name. I know my great-great-grandfather's name. My father's name was Safdar. His father's name was Riyasat. His father's name was Ismail. His father's name was Sherban. Before that, I don't know. I can only go back four generations. But a Sayyid who has a family tree, or an Abbasi who has a family tree, they would go through their family tree and they'll say, my 14th great-grandfather's name was so-and-so. My 16th great-grandfather's name was so-and-so. And most of us, many of us, because Hindustan, India, Bar-e-Saghir, Pakistan, prior there was a lot of Hindus who lived there. And if we go back, maybe our ancestors were Hindus. They had become Muslim, they accepted Islam, and from there it continued. But when it comes to Sadat, Ali Rasul, the Ahlul Bayt, they don't have no kufr, no shirk inside them. They have been Muslim all the way back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And this is a noble lineage. And when we look at Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah, his progeny ended because both his children passed away in their infancy. He radiallahu ta'ala anhu participated in all the major battles. He took part in Badr, he took part in Uhud, he took part in Khandaq, he took part in Khaybar, in every single battle. And it was in Badr that he seen his father, Abdullah ibn al-Jarrah. And his father was staunch against the Muslims. He did not like the Muslims. He did not accept Islam. So he is now encountering his father on the battlefield. This is the plains of Badr, the 313 Sahaba there. 313 of them are standing ready, waiting. In number they are weak, because there's 1,000 mushrikeen of the Quraysh. 1,000 who have come from Mecca. And they are ready to fight against the Muslims. They are ready to fight and to end Islam. And you've got Sayyidina Bilal standing there. You've got Sayyidina Ammar bin Yasir standing there. You've got Sayyidina Ali, who is a young man, standing there. You have Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, their major companions are standing there. Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah is standing there, and in the battlefield at that time, he's fighting and he sees his father keeps coming to him. His father is eyeing him up and trying to kill his own son. And Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah is avoiding him, because this is my father, I don't want to encounter him. It came to a point where the father attempted to kill him. And Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah killed him. He killed his father in the battlefield. Why? Because the love of Islam and Iman was more than the love of your own father here. He put the Quran ahead of his own father. He put Islam ahead of his own father. And then when word had spread amongst the people that Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah has killed his father in the battlefield, Allah Jalla wa Ala sent the verse, لَا تَجِدُ قَوْمًا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ يوادون من حاد الله ورسوله ولو كانوا آباؤهم أو أبناؤهم أو إخوانهم أو عشيرتهم أولئك كتب في قلوبهم الإيمان. Allah Almighty in the Quran said, لا تجد قوما يؤمنون بالله واليوم الآخر. They will not find, you will not find a nation, a group of mu'mins, believers, who have iman in Allah on the final day, who will love those who oppose Allah and His Rasul. How can you have iman in your heart and those that are against Allah and His Rasul and the Shariat, you love them? In many ways, the Quran is telling us our desire and love for these non-Muslim superstars and pop stars like Rihanna and these musicians and these Drakes and all this that the young people listen to, for example. Our love and desire for them. How can you love them when they are enemies of Allah on the Day of Judgment? They have no faith in Allah and His Rasul alayhi salatu wasalam. They are plotting and scheming against Islam. How can you love them? You will not find a group of people who believe in Allah and the final day loving those who oppose Allah and His Messenger. And when Allah Almighty said, those man hada Allah wa rasulahu, those who go against Allah and His Rasul, Allah Almighty adds the next part. Walau kana aba'uhum. Even if it's their own fathers, even walau kanu aba'uhum aw abna'uhum, even if it's their fathers that are against Allah and His Rasul, they don't love their father. If they had to choose between Allah and His Rasul and their father who doesn't believe, Allah and His Rasul is first, father comes after. If it's their own children, Allah and His Rasul come first, or the children, Allah and His Rasul will come first. Children after. I'm not talking about believing children or believing parents. Those who are Muslim parents or Muslim children. I'm talking those who are non-Muslim. Because the people questioned Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. Allah said, how can you question him when he has put Allah and His Rasul and Yawm al-Akhir ahead of everything? To the point that his father was trying to kill him, he killed his father. That you are an enemy of Islam. You are an enemy of Allah and His Rasul. Whether you are my father or not, I must kill you for the sake of Allah. And where at that moment, وَلَوْ كَانُوا آبَاؤُهُمْ أَوْ أَبْنَاؤُهُمْ أَوْ إِخْوَانُهُمْ أَوْ عَشِيرَتُهُمْ, whether it's their fathers, whether it's their children, whether it's their relatives, it's their brethren, then Allah said, أُولَٰئِكَ كَتَبَ فِي قُلُوبِهُمُ الْإِيمَانِ. Allah Almighty has engraved iman deep into their hearts. These are the people who have true iman. وَأَيَّدْنَاهُ بِرُوحٍ مِّنْهُ وَأَيَّدَهُمْ بِرُوحٍ مِّنْهُ, and He supported them with Sayyidina Jibreel. وَيُدْخِلُهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. And for these people who believe in Allah and His Rasul so much, that Allah and His Rasul will precede their fathers, their children, their brethren who don't believe, who oppose Allah and His Rasul, about them Allah Almighty has promised them paradise beneath their feet which rivers will flow. And then Allah Almighty said, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْ, Allah is pleased with them. they are pleased with Allah. أُولَٰئِكَ حِزْبُ اللَّهِ. This is the army of Allah. أَلَا إِنَّ حِزْبَ اللَّهِ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And certainly it is the army of Allah that will succeed. So Allah Almighty in the Quran is praising Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah for this action. And then we see, this was in Badr, Muslims are victorious. They met again in Uhud. About Uhud, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Uhudun jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbuhu. Uhud is a mountain. We love this mountain and this mountain loves us. You know, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is making a huge statement here. Ya Rasulullah, love is a emotion of the heart. It's a state. It's a kayfiyah. It's a hal that you can only feel in your qalb. To love something. Oh, Allah's Messenger, how are you saying that Uhud is a mountain? We believe it's a mountain. But how can you say Uhud, a mountain, loves us and we love this mountain? And we believe that anything Rasulullah ﷺ touched, Nabir, innate objects, he gave life to them. The Prophet, this was one of his miracles. He would give life to innate objects. It's like when Abu Jahl picked the pebbles up. And he said to the Prophet, if you truly are the messenger of Allah, then tell me, what do I have in my hand? How many pebbles? And the Prophet said, Abu Jahl, do you want me to tell you what's in your hand, or do you want what's in your hand to tell you who I am? Do you want what's in your hand to tell you who I am? Abu Jahl threw it. As soon as he threw it, a sound came from the pebbles. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. Seven pebbles read the kalima, and Abu Jahl heard this. This was a miracle. This was a mu'jiza. This is something which defied logic. It defies the laws of nature, the laws of science. This is what you call a miracle, something which is beyond the mind and comprehension. You can't imagine this, but this is what is recorded. And the Prophet alayhi salam performed this miracle. So these were miracles of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And when he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Uhudun jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbuhu. Uhud is a mountain, he loves us and we love it. Why does he love us and why do we love it? Because the Prophet alayhi salam stood on Uhud one day and the mountain began to shake. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Uthbut ya Uhud. Relax Uhud, stay firm Uhud, stop shaking Uhud. Do you know who's upon you right now? There is a Nabi of Allah. There is the Siddiq Abu Bakr. And two Shaheed are standing upon you. Sayyidina Umar and Uthman. Relax Uhud, don't worry. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, Uhud is a mountain on the day of Qiyamah. Allah Almighty will enter Uhud into Jannatul Firdaus as well. It will be a mountain from the mountains of paradise. This is the power of Uhud. And it was in this battle of Uhud when the Muslims were under siege and attack. Such was the state, and I finish on this, and I will continue next week on Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah, that Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came under immense attack. At one point when Nabi alayhi salam, and you see Uhud is it's an entire battle that I can talk about. One day inshallah we'll talk about the battle of Uhud. In short, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said to 50 archers, that your duty is to stay upon the mountain of Uhud. Do not leave your post. Don't leave your post. And this battalion of 50 archers was manned by Sayyidina Abdullah bin Jahsh radiallahu anhu. So the 50 were stood there. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu was a Muslim at this time. Sayyidina Khalid hadn't accepted Islam. He was waiting throughout this battle whilst the Muslims fought the Quraysh. They were fighting one another. He was waiting. He didn't make no move. When the Muslims were taking the Quraysh or the Mushrikeen back, they were retreating and they were victorious and winning this battle. The 50 archers, some of them were young men, and they started running from the mountain and joining in with the celebration. That we are victorious here. Look, we're about to win this battle. It's great news, great news. We're about to win. At that moment in time, Abdullah bin Jahsh said, where are you going? Where are you going? The Prophet ﷺ told us, at all costs, do not leave your posts. As soon as they ran from the mountain down, so you have the Mushrikeen here, you have the Muslims here, and then you had the archers running down, Khalid bin Walid was waiting for this one moment throughout this battle. This is why he's regarded as the greatest Muslim general commander that the Muslim Ummah has ever seen. never tasted defeat in his life. He took his battalion of 100, 200 horses, and he went around the rear of the Muslim Ummah, the Muslim army at that time, and sandwiched the Muslims. When he sandwiched, he got Khalid bin Walid from this side, you have the Mushrikeen and the Muslims in the middle. And they were being attacked. They were heavily attacked. All of a sudden, the tide turned. And there was one critical moment when the tide turned. The one who was holding the flag in this battle was a man called Mus'ab bin Umair. I spoke about him before. Mus'ab bin Umair, he physically resembled the Prophet ﷺ. He was killed in this battle. The flag dropped, the flag of Islam. Word spread that the Prophet ﷺ, aliyadu billah, has been killed. So there was panic amongst the Muslims that the Messenger of Allah is killed. Everyone started looking to find the Prophet ﷺ. Is he alive? What's happened? When they found the Prophet ﷺ, Nabi ﷺ had been struck so hard by the mushrikeen surrounded that they were thrown into a ditch. A deep ditch was dug in Uhud and they were thrown inside that. And the mushrikeen were hitting Rasulullah ﷺ on their metal helmet. To such an extent, Nabi alayhi salam was being attacked by the mushrikeen in Uhud that they had two metal rings around their face to protect their face. Both those rings pierced their cheeks. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah and Abu Bakr Siddiq was looking what's happening here quickly. When they seen where the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was, they ran. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the greatest man from the Sahaba, he said, I looked to my right and there was a lightning or a man like a lightning running. And it was Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. Before we arrived to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was a man standing with arrows in his back. And he was cut up in his back. It was Talha bin Ubaidullah. His hands had been cut. Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah seen the Prophet ﷺ. And he seen that inside their cheeks were two rings. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, give me permission, please. I'm going to take these out. And you know how he took them out? He took them out with his mouth. When he took one ring out, he lost his middle tooth here from the top of his teeth. Then he took the second one out, he lost his second one. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, I never seen a more handsome man without teeth, more handsome than Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. He was beautiful. He was beautiful the way he looked. He had, you know why? He lost his teeth to save the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah fought in Uhud. Fought like none of the Sahaba fought. Talha bin Ubaid, these men made their name. They became legends. Legends of the Muslim Ummah. Then men like Sayyidina Talha, you have a son, name your son Talha. And when you name him Talha, know why you named him Talha. Because I named him after a legend of the Muslims. This was a man who the Prophet ﷺ looked at and said, Man arada an yanzura ila rajulim min jannah, falyanzur ila Talha ibn Ubaidillah. You want to look at a man who's walking on this earth from paradise, a heavenly man. Then look at Talha bin Ubaidillah. And when they looked at Sayyidina Talha, he was walking with a limp. His back was curled. He had such a deep wound in his shoulder that it is said that you could put your hand inside his shoulder blade here. Such a deep wound. Suffered all of these were men. These were the soldiers of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah, the Prophet alayhi salam said, لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ أَمِينٌ وَأَمِينُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ أَبُوْ أُبَيْدَةِ. Every nation had a trustee. And the trustee of my nation and my ummah is Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. And he was, when the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam left this world, Sayyidina Abu Bakr became the Khalifa. And when Sayyidina Abu Bakr, before he was appointed the Khalifa, he looked and he said, do you know who I think should be the Khalifa? There are two people worthy of this caliphate greater than me right now. Umar bin al-Khattab, Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. These two men are the greatest men on this earth right now. And when they looked at Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah, what did they say? He was a skinny, tall man. And he had a thin beard. And he had no front teeth. And when they looked at the companions knew And there was times when Sayyidina Umar used to write letters to Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. And he appointed him as the leader, and he was the conqueror of Damascus. Next week, inshallah, we'll discuss this. And this entire ummah, the trustee, the most trustworthy in this ummah, is Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. When Sayyidina Abu Bakr was appointed the Khalifa, he said, the trustee of the Muslim mal, the Baytul mal, the treasury, the Muslim treasury, the one who will be in charge of this, to take care of this, will be Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. Because there is no man more trustworthy on this earth than this man. And this was honored and given to him. This title was given to him by the Prophet ﷺ. وَأَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا أَسْتَغْفُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَأَخْرُ دَعْوَايَا أَنِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ
يَا إِمَامَ رُسْلِ يَا سَنَدِي أَنْتَ بَابُ اللَّهِ مُعْتَمَدِ فَبِدُنْيَايَا وآخرتي
يا رسول الله خذ بيدي.